Assalamu alaikum students, I am Dr. Asma Sidduqie from anatomy department. In embryology lectures, as you know, we were doing the development of gastrointestinal system. So far we have already done with the development of foregut and midgut. And as I told you in the lectures, that these two pictures you must be in your mind always whenever there is a gastrointestinal development, its questions, its viva, you must remember this table and this picture, which is self-explanatory and it is telling you everything. In the foregut derivatives, you know that is starting from esophagus till there is the hepatic bud, which you can see in this picture, that from the esophagus till the hepatic bud or hepatic diverticulum, which we say that this is the area where there is opening of bile duct in the duodenum. These areas include the foregut derived structures. It has its own blood vessel, that is the celiac artery, and around that celiac artery there is the celiac plexus, which is supplying its innervation to the foregut areas. That is its autonomic innervation. Then for the midgut, this is the area which is beyond the opening of bile duct, or you can say that is the area of hepatic diverticulum down here, making the parts of the duodenum. And then there is one cephalic and caudal loop of the midgut, which is connected to the umbilical cord through this vitelline duct, that is the future area of Meckel's diverticulum. It has its blood vessel, that is superior mesenteric artery, and around that the superior mesenteric plexus, which is the continuation of the celiac plexus and its descending branches, it is supplying autonomic innervation to the midgut area. Then this is the demarcation of midgut, is that is the area which is the junction of right 2/3 and left 1/3 of the transverse colon. Beyond that distal third or left 1/3 of transverse colon to the descending colon, sigmoid colon, till the upper part of the anal canal, that is the area of hindgut. This is not only providing and deriving these structures, there is also this area which is the expanded portion of this gut tube, that is known as cloaca. This cloaca is dividing into the anal canal posteriorly and urogenital canal. In the this lecture I will told you how these are going to be separated. So this is the portion here that is for the urinary bladder. So there is also the region of epithelium of the urinary bladder and most of the urethra. This is derived from endodermal tissue from hindgut. So urinary bladder epithelium is endodermal in origin, you must remember. It has its blood vessel, that is inferior mesenteric artery, and its plexus is same, the descending branches from the celiac plexus through this inferior mesenteric plexus, that is supplying. So starting from the beginning, there is the development of trilaminar germ disc at the third week of intrauterine life. Ectoderm, mesoderm, and this yellow colored endoderm, which is actually lining the yolk sac, that is going to develop in the third week of intrauterine life. After that, in intrauterine life, there is very important process that is taking place, which is the folding in cephalocaudal direction. Because of this cephalocaudal folding, if you follow it, there is relocation of very important organs to its normal position. It is relocating this pericardial cavity and heart from its cranial most position to the anterior midline position, if you follow it. So also it is incorporating along with it that endodermal lined yolk sac into the embryo. So when this cephalocaudal folding is completed, you can see here that endodermal lined yolk sac is completely incorporated into the embryo in a form of a tubal structure. This is known as gut tube that is going to be present, and formed because of incorporation of endoderm into the embryo because of cephalocaudal foldings. Here there is only one connection to the yolk sac, which you can appreciate here, that is its vitelointestinal duct or vitelline duct, which is connecting this midgut tube to the yolk sac, and this process is going to narrows down in future, as you know. Here this expanded portion at the caudal end, that is cloaca, and this is also having this endodermal sausage like expansion into the connecting stalk towards the umbilicus, that is allantois. So starting here with the development of hindgut, as we have completed the development of midgut and foregut in the lectures, so we only left with the development of hindgut. So as I have told you that the hindgut derivatives are from the left third of transverse colon to the left colic flexor, descending colon, sigmoid colon, rectum, till the upper half of the anal canal. These are the structures which are derived from the hindgut tube. This is also giving the epithelium of urinary bladder, because that is the structure derived from cloaca. And it is supplied by the inferior mesenteric artery, which is the artery of the hindgut. From this arrow you can see here. So beyond that, this whole area that is making up the structures and organs which are derived from the hindgut. So here in this picture you can see that from this connecting stalk, this is the vitelline duct. You can appreciate this is the area of midgut. So descending down, then rest this whole portion that is making up the part of the hindgut. This is the dilated portion at the caudalmost area of the hindgut tube, which is known as cloaca. It has to be divided into two components: the more anterior component, that is the urogenital component, and the posterior one is making the anal canal. So from here, this allantois, which is also connecting this cloaca towards that connecting stalk, this is more towards the urogenital side. So that urogenital component is making up the urinary bladder. So this urinary bladder, through this allantois that is connected towards the umbilicus, which is in future it is making up the urethrus. So urethrus is the remnant of allantois that is connected to the apex or upper part of the urinary bladder, which is derived from cloaca. So that's how I told you that this urinary bladder, its epithelium, and some part of the epithelium of urethra is derived from. So in this picture I would like to describe you how that cloaca is dividing it into two components. Actually there is this mesodermal ridge, which is the expanded ridge from connecting stalk, that is moving and migrating down between the lowermost portion of hind gut, that is starting from sigmoid colon. Beyond that, this portion of mesodermal tissue that is expanding and migrating towards the area, that is the area of cloacal membrane. So when it reaches to the cloacal membrane, that is completely dividing that cloaca into anterior urogenital part, that is the urogenital canal here, which is developing into the urogenital structures, and posteriorly this is the anal canal. So actually that is the urorectal septum, which is the mesodermal ridge extending down from the sigmoid colon till the anal canal, and it reaches and approximating with the cloacal membrane and dividing the cloaca into anterior. The expanded terminal portion of the hindgut is known as cloaca. Here you can follow this cloaca that is divided into its ventral and dorsal parts because of the migration of this urorectal septum. The urorectal septum is the mesodermal thickening and ridge, which is extending down and continues down from the connecting stalk. So from this connecting stalk, this mesodermal ridge, which is migrating down towards cloacal membrane, this is known as urorectal septum. It is forming a partition into the cloaca and dividing it into its ventral portion, which is the urogenital sinus or urogenital canal, and the posterior partition is the anal canal, which is its dorsal portion. So this urorectal septum is not only dividing the cloaca into ventral and dorsal parts, it also divides the cloacal membrane into the anterior one, which is overlying that urogenital sinus. This is urogenital membrane. And the portion of the cloacal membrane which overlies anal canal is anal membrane. And where this urorectal septum fuses in the perineum at proctodium, that is making here the perineal body. That anal membrane, here it overlies the anal pit area, which is because of the proliferation of the cells. And this anal pit and the anal membrane, later on in future, because of the degeneration of that membrane and rupture of the membrane, leading to formation of opening, which is known as anus. So through that opening and anus, the anal canal is to understand the partitioning of cloaca because of urorectal septum, you can follow the colors here. This is cloacal membrane, which is shown red. And here this is the expanded portion cloaca that is overlaid by this cloacal membrane. This cloaca here, you can easily see that is making that sausage-like diverticulum ventrally, which is extending towards the umbilical cord or connecting stalk. This is allantois. Its future remnant is urethrus. Then dorsally, this is making that portion which is the anal canal, and this green is the hindgut. Follow that star. This star is actually the urorectal septum, which is extending down. Here in this slide, you can easily appreciate this is the mesodermal ridge, which is extending towards the cloacal membrane and dividing ventrally the urogenital sinus and dorsally the cloacal sinus. And this is the membranes, cloacal membranes. In this slide, you can also see that the urorectal septum extending down towards the cloacal membrane and ventrally dividing it into the urogenital sinus or urogenital canal, and this dorsal part is the anal canal, and it is also dividing cloacal membrane here, that is overlying that anal canal is anal membrane. This is going to rupture because of the degradation of the cells later on, making here the anus, the future opening from where anal canal is communicating to the exterior. And ventrally here, this is the urogenital membrane, which is overlying that urogenital sinus. The portion where that urorectal septum fuse at the proctodium, here it is making that perineal body, where many perineal muscles converge and get their attachments. So this is the picture from your book, and here you can also very easily and clearly understand that from the connecting stalk, the mesodermal tissue that is extended and migrating down towards the cloacal membrane. And that cloacal membrane was the area of proctodium, which I have already told you is the juxtaposition of ectoderm and endoderm of the yolk sac. So that is externally lined by the ectoderm as well. So this ridge that is not only dividing the cloaca into its anterior urogenital canal and posterior anal canal, it is also dividing this proctodium when that urorectal septum fused and joined that proctodium at cloacal membrane here, that is also dividing its anterior portion, which is overlying that urogenital canal, as a urogenital membrane, and the one which is lining along that anal canal, that is, so if you follow that picture here, you can see that urorectal septum that is migrating and dividing that terminal dilated portion of cloaca into the anterior urogenital canal, which is also known as urogenital sinus, and posterior anal canal. And the area where that urorectal septum fuses with the proctodium, that point is making up in future the perineal body. The perineal body is the tendinous center of the perineum. Here that fibromuscular node, that is the landmark of several perineal muscles which converge and attach there. This urorectal septum is also dividing the sphincter, which is the cloacal sphincter, into the anterior portion and posterior part. The posterior part of that cloacal sphincter becomes external anal sphincter, and its anterior portion of that sphincter develops into the superficial transverse perineal bulbospongiosis and ischiocavernosis muscle. So now here, that posterior portion that is making up anal canal, that for the development of anal canal, you must remember that this is developing by two germ layers. The contribution of the endoderm, that is for its superior portion, its superior two-third, which is approximately 25 millimeter of adult anal canal, this is derived from hindgut. So that is endodermal in origin. That portion which is inferior, it is developing from the proctodium. So that is inferior lower approximately 13 to 15 millimeter anal canal, that is developing from the proctodium. So this is ectodermal in origin. The demarcation line which is indicated here, that is this pectinate line, which is the line, joining line of the inferior portions of anal valves. So above that pectinate line is the anal canal, which is endodermal in origin, and below that pectinate line is the ectodermal anal canal. So that inferior portion of anal canal that ends up at anus, which is the communicating point of the anal canal to exterior. So here at this anus, if you see approximately 2 millimeter above to that opening of anus, there is another line that can be demarcated. This is the white line of Hilton's or anocutaneous line. The anocutaneous line is the line where actually the composition of the anal canal epithelium, that is changing from above the columnar epithelium of hindgut, is changing towards completely the stratified squamous keratinized epithelium of lower anal canal, that is from proctodium. So this area is actually the changing and transition line, transition zone of the epithelium from the columnar to the stratified squamous keratinized epithelium. Also, there is the appearance of glandular structures which are present in the skin. So above the white line, the sweat glands are absent, and below the white line here, the sweat glands, hair follicles, and all the characteristic features as that of a skin that can be appreciated. So now you can very easily understand the embryological basis of the difference in the blood supply, nerve supply, and lymphatic drainage of the upper portion of anal canal and the lower portion of the anal canal. These are different because the upper two-thirds, that is derived from the endoderm of hindgut, and the lower portion is from the ectoderm of proctodium. So there is difference in the blood supply, innervation, and lymphatic drainage. So the arterial supply of that upper portion, which is the hindgut portion, It is receiving the arterial supply from the branches of inferior mesenteric artery, because this is the artery of hind gut, you know very well. And the lower portion, that is receiving arterial supply from the branches of internal iliac artery. So for the venous drainage, the upper portion that drains its venous blood into the inferior mesenteric vein, and then through that it enters into the portal venous system. And the lower portion that is having systemic circulation, so it is going to enter, its venous blood is entering directly into the vena cava through the internal iliac vein. If you see the nerve supply, the upper portion, which is from the hind gut, that receives autonomic innervation from inferior hypogastric plexus, and it is pain insensitive area. The portion which is below the pectinate line and ectodermal inner region, it receives somatic innervation and sensory innervation through the inferior rectal nerve, that is very sensitive to pain. And the area which is above the pectinate line, its lymphatic drainage is into the internal iliac lymph nodes, and below the pectinate line, lymphatic drainage is into the superficial inguinal lymph nodes. This is also very important clinically, because the metastasis of the carcinoma of anal canal, that is also different in upper portion and in the lower portion. When considering the metastasis of and spread of the cancer cells, the upper part carcinoma, which is from the endodermal region, the carcinoma of this superior part, that is arising from columnar epithelium, and this is painless, and its lymphatic spread is towards the internal iliac lymph node. The carcinoma of the lower part, that is arising from the stratified squamous epithelium, it is very painful, because that is pain sensitive area receiving somatic and sensory innervation, and its lymphatic spread is towards the superficial inguinal lymph nodes. So these are going to enlarge when there is. So the most important congenital defect associated with the hindgut is congenital megacolon. This is also known as Hirschsprung's disease. Congenital megacolon is associated with the failure of neural crest cells to migrate into the myenteric or Auerbach's plexus to form the parasympathetic vagal cells there. So there is absent ganglions, parasympathetic ganglions in that region, which is the denervated or aganglionated region. It is also known as aganglionosis. This is leading to the failure of relaxation of that part that remain constricted, and the portion which is proximal and above to that defected portion, it is going to become distended. There is more and more relaxation and distended portion leading to that megacolon. So actually this megacolon portion is the normal portion, but the portion which is distal to that, it has congenital defect because of the failure of migration of neural crest cells and formation of parasympathetic vagal neurons in the plexus present in the walls of gut. So this is going to remain constricted portion. So we can be remove that defect and correct it surgically by removing that area. This contrast imaging study is the barium enema, in which the contrast material, that is barium, it is introduced through the anal canal, and then images are taken. So in this imaging film, you can appreciate here, this is huge dilated portion. So that is a typical picture of the Hirschsprung's disease or congenital megacolon, in which that dilated portion is the normal healthy portion. And below distally, this is mainly affecting the sigmoid colon and the rectum, which become constricted. They are constricted because of aganglionosis. Here is the failure of migration of neural crest cells, which are responsible to develop the neurons of the parasympathetic vagal nerves. So when this parasympathetic innervation is defective, this is leading to the constricted part here in this gut area. So that just resembles a bird's beak. So you can say that this bird's beak appearance is typically shown in the Hirschsprung's disease or congenital megacolon. This appearance, just like that bird's beak appearance, can be seen anywhere when there will be a distal portion which show constriction, or that is the this picture is showing you the rectoperineal fistula. This is associated with the anal agenesis. There is absent anal canal. Because of the absent and defective anal canal development, the rectum, it is directly going to communicate to the perineum through that narrow fistula. So this is known as rectoperineal fistula, which is associated. For the other congenital defects associated with hindgut, I will show you in this picture one by one. In this picture A, as you have seen, this is persistent cloaca. The cloaca, which is the terminal expanded portion of hindgut, it has to be separated because of urorectal septum. So when there is absent urorectal septum or failure of the migration of urorectal septum down, it is not leading to partition, which is normally dividing the cloaca into anterior and posterior portions. So here you can see a combined cloacal opening through which the urogenital structures and anal canal is communicating out. So this anal canal, that is making here that fistula, which is rectocloacal fistula. So in persistent cloaca, there is complete absence of the development of urorectal septum. In this picture B, you can see there is anal stenosis. It is associated with the posterior deviation of urorectal septum. When urorectal septum, while migrating down towards cloacal membrane, it is deviated more towards the posterior side, it leads to narrowing down of anal canal. And this is anal stenosis. In this picture C, there is persistent anal membrane. As you have seen, that urorectal septum also divides the cloacal membrane into the urogenital membrane anteriorly and anal membrane. So the anal membrane, which is overlying anal canal, it is not going to rupture, and there is absent degeneration of the cells. Then this leads to the persistent anal membrane, and this is also known as the membranous anal atresia. Picture D and E are associated with renal agenesis, as I have shown you in the previous slide as well. Here is the absent anal canal. So because of this absent anal canal, the rectum is directly going to the communicate to anal membrane here. So this is making with perineum one fistula, that is anoperineal or rectoperineal fistula. So absence of anal canal, that is known as anal agenesis, and this is associated with that rectoperineal or anoperineal fistula if somehow small length of anal canal is present, as shown in this picture. So here, this is again because of the early stoppage and failure of migration of the urorectal septum. So when this is leading to a early stoppage and early failure of migration of urorectal septum, which is not completely migrating down till cloacal membrane, it is leading to that fistula formation again, that is rectovaginal fistula in the females. And in the same case in the males, it leads to the rectourethral fistula. The rectum is directly communicating with the urinary canal. So in this case, the rectourethral fistula, the fecal matter is passing out through the urine as well. And here in rectovaginal fistula, the fecal matter is passing out through the vaginal orifice. So that fistulas, they are again, all these defects are mostly, you must remember, are because of defective urorectal septum. If there is either failure of its migration or its more deviated migration ho jayegi, so then this is leading to such conditions. So these two, H and I, these are associated with rectal atresia. Here there is absent anal canal with blind ended rectum. This is leading to obstruction, and this is rectal atresia with anal agenesis. And here this is rectal atresia with small portion of anal canal that has developed here, but it is non-functional. So these can be leading to obstruction, or these two conditions are also known as imperforate anus, in which the rectum or anal canal that is going to stenosed at higher up level. So there can be two types of imperforate anus, the high anomalies and low anomalies. These are depending upon the puborectal sling. The puborectalis muscle, which is making puborectal sling in the levator ani muscle that is surrounding that rectum and anal canal. So if that sling if this atresia is above the puborectal sling, then this is known as high anomaly of imperforate anus. And if this rectal atresia is below the puborectal sling, then this is low anomaly of the imperforate anus. The low anomalies can easily be corrected by the surgical procedures, but high anomalies which are above the puborectal slings, they have the danger to cutting off the puborectal sling as well, which leads to the incontinence. So during correction of high anomalies of imperforate anus, there can be the chances of incontinence of the fecal matter. So these two, which are the rectal atresias, these are also called imperforate anus, you must remember. And again, this imperforate anus is because of the defective, or this is because of the abnormal development of urorectal septum. This is leading to the incomplete separation of urogenital sinus anteriorly and anal canal posteriorly. So incomplete separation of cloaca leads to that imperforate anus. So imperforate anus, that is very important for university questions. So you must study it from the book as well, I recommend you. So here I end up with all the development of gastrointestinal tract. Students, I hope you listen it very carefully. Thank you very much for your patience, and I hope you are safe and healthy at home. But please, you have to work hard and study well.